Students, in today's lecture we will see the remaining definitions from thermodynamics as heat capacity, enthalpy, exact and inexact differential. In the previous lecture we have seen a lot of recapitulation of a thermodynamics. So in today's lecture we will see just heat capacity, enthalpy, exact and inexact differentials. So see, first point is heat capacity. So heat capacity means what? It is the amount of heat absorbed by a substance. It's directly proportional to the temperature change. That is, Q is directly proportional to delta T, and delta T represents the change in temperature. That is Tf minus Ti. And Q means the heat. So Q is equal to heat capacity into delta T, or heat is equal to heat capacity into delta T. This is our equation. In this equation, Q is directly proportional to change in temperature, where heat capacity is constant of proportionality. Heat capacity is equal to Q divided by this delta T. That is, heat capacity is equal to heat divided by delta T. Now, the amount of heat required to raise the temperature of given amount of substance by 1 Kelvin is called as heat capacity. Simply, you have taken a substance and its heat or the temperature of a given amount of substance is increased by 1 Kelvin after providing a amount of heat. This is the heat capacity. Now, the heat capacity is expressed in terms of joules per Kelvin. So, heat capacity is equal to heat divided by delta T, and unit of change in temperature is Kelvin and heat is measured in joule. That's why heat capacity is expressed in terms of joules per Kelvin. Then the next definition of the heat capacity is specific heat capacity. The specific heat capacity is the amount of heat which is required to raise the temperature of 1 gram of a substance by 1 Kelvin is called the specific heat capacity. Means you have taken 1 gram of substance and we want to increase its temperature by 1 Kelvin. So, how much amount of heat is required for the increase of a heat or temperature by 1 Kelvin? So, this amount of heat is called as a specific heat capacity. Then, this specific heat capacity is expressed in joules per gram per Kelvin, because we have specifically taken substance 1 gram. So, unit will be changed from joule per Kelvin to joule per gram per Kelvin. So, see, specific heat capacity, which is denoted by C, is equal to heat divided by M into delta T. So, M is a mass, that is 1 gram. So, heat is expressed in joules and M expressed in gram and delta T in Kelvin. So, unit of specific heat capacity will be joules per gram per Kelvin. So, this is the specific heat capacity. Now, the next term is molar heat capacity. Now, instead of gram, we are going to take 1 mole of substance and we want to increase its temperature by 1 Kelvin. So, the amount of heat required to raise the temperature of 1 mole of substance by 1 Kelvin, this is called as a molar heat capacity. And again, SI unit will be changed, because here we have taken 1 mole of substance. In the specific heat capacity, we have taken 1 gram of substance, that's why unit will be changed. Now here 1 mole of substance is taken, therefore unit will be joule per mole per Kelvin. So see how this unit came, molar heat capacity is equal to heat divided by delta T. This term remains same, but addition is moles. So heat divided by moles into delta T. So heat is expressed in joule, moles and temperature is expressed in Kelvin, and these terms are in the derivation. That's why heat into mole inverse into delta T inverse, its unit will be joule per mole per Kelvin. So this is the unit of molar heat capacity. Now the molar heat capacity can be expressed in two ways. Molar heat capacity at constant pressure, this is one way, and molar heat capacity at constant volume, this will be second. So initially we will see molar heat capacity at constant pressure. So see, if the quantity of heat Q is absorbed by n moles of the substance and its temperature raises from T1 to T2, like T initial to T final, and its molar heat capacity is given by C is equal to heat divided by number of moles n into delta T. So C is equal to Q divided by n in bracket T2 minus T1. So delta T is represented by T2 minus T1. So equation is here, heat divided by number of moles n into delta T, that is change in temperature. So since the heat absorbed by a substance at constant pressure is equal to delta H, that means when pressure is constant, Q is equal to delta H. Here I have written QP. P represents the pressure. So heat at constant pressure is equal to delta H. So we can write, instead of QP is written here, and then QP is equal to delta H. Therefore just write the equation as CP, because pressure is constant. So we can write the heat capacity, and heat capacity is the molar heat capacity here. So molar heat capacity at constant pressure, that is denoted by CP, is equal to QP divided by N into delta T. It's equal to delta H divided by N into delta T. And now you can rearrange equation as delta H is equal to N into CP into delta T. This is the equation, and here CP is the molar heat capacity of a substance at constant pressure. So this is the simple equation, CP is equal to delta H divided by N into delta T, that is molar heat capacity at constant pressure. Now we will see the molar heat capacity at constant volume. So see, molar heat capacity at constant volume, here when volume is constant, again you can write QV is equal to delta H is equal to delta E, that is change in energy. That's why the equation can be written as, and our definition is, molar heat capacity at constant volume is equal to QV divided by N into delta T. N represents again the number of moles of substance. So CV is the molar heat capacity at constant volume. QA is the heat at constant volume. Delta T is the change in temperature. So just write QV is equal to delta E and rewrite equation as CV is equal to delta E divided by N into delta T. So just rearrange our equation. Delta E is equal to CV into N into delta T. So this equation can be written as delta E is equal to N into CV into delta T. So delta E represents the change in energy, N is number of moles, CV is the molar heat capacity at constant volume, and delta T is the temperature change. So temperature will be Tf minus Ti or T2 minus T1. Now using specific heat of a substance, the quantity of heat absorbed or evaluated can be calculated as. So absorbed or evolved heat can be calculated as C is equal to Q divided by M into delta T. This is a molar heat capacity. So M is taken here. Q is equal to M into C into delta T. So just rearrange this equation as Q is equal to M into C into delta T. So similarly, by the amount of heat can be calculated using molar heat capacity. In the molar heat capacity, we have taken number of moles, and in the specific heat capacity, we have taken the mass. So M represents mass of a substance, which is in gram, and N represents the number of moles. This definition is of a molar heat capacity, and this one is of a specific heat capacity. So we want to calculate the heat of the molar heat capacity. So therefore, when molar heat capacity is there, we can calculate heat as Q is equal to N into C into delta T. This is our equation. Then the heat can be measured by using calorimetry. So a device which measures heat flow is called as a calorimeter. And calorimetry is the science of measuring heat of chemical reaction by measuring the temperature change, that is delta T. Now we will see second definition of today's lecture, that is enthalpy. So enthalpy is denoted by capital H and is the sum of the internal energy U plus a pressure volume term. So see, the equation is delta H of reaction, that is the enthalpy of reaction, is equal to delta U of reaction plus P delta V. Or simply you can write this equation as H is equal to U plus PV. So PV represents the pressure volume work, delta U represents the change in internal energy of the system or the reaction, and delta H represents the enthalpy of the reaction. Now the enthalpy is a state function, and the big difference between the delta H and delta U is the little bit of pressure volume work that the reaction does to expand against the pressure. And constant pressure versus constant volume conditions are given here. Delta H is the heat of reaction under constant pressure conditions. That means the volume will be changed and pressure is constant. So delta H is equal to delta U plus P delta V. When pressure is constant, equation will be different. And when volume is constant, equation will be different. So see here, constant pressure versus constant volume conditions are given here. Delta H is the heat of the reaction under constant pressure conditions. This means the volume can change. So volume will be changed, and the delta H is equal to QP. The equation we have already seen: when pressure is constant, at that time heat is equal to change in enthalpy. And when the internal energy change, delta U, is the heat under the constant volume conditions, the volume can't change, so there is no pressure volume type of work is done during the reaction, and change in volume delta V is equal to zero. See, our definition of enthalpy is delta H is equal to delta U plus P delta V. And when volume is constant, you can write delta V is equal to zero. So delta U plus P into zero. So this term will be neglected directly. So delta U is equal to delta H. And we know that delta H is equal to QP. So same way you can write it as a QV. When volume is constant, QV. When pressure is constant, QP. That's why here, when constant pressure versus constant volume conditions are there, and when pressure is constant or the volume is constant, this term will be neglected and our equation become delta U is equal to QV, and here delta H is equal to QP. When pressure constant, equation is delta H is equal to QP, and when volume is constant, delta U is equal to QV. So here you can directly write delta H is equal to delta U is equal to QV when volume is constant. And this is the enthalpy of reaction. This diagram shows how enthalpy will be changed. And now the exact and inexact differentials. So exact and inexact differentials are the important in the thermodynamics. If system is taken along a path, for example system is heated, then internal energy will be changes from initial to the final state, that is EY to UF, or the internal energy of the initial state to the internal energy of the final state. And the overall change is the sum of all infinitesimal changes along the path. That is, delta U is equal to integration of UI to UF into DU. So internal energy changes from UI to UF. So you can write UF minus UI. So delta U depends upon initial and final states of the system, but delta U is independent of the path between this. This path independence of the integral is expressed by saying that change in internal energy is a exact differential. So you can write this equation as a delta. So the terms which you are writing as a delta, all these terms are exact differentials. And exact differential is an infinitesimal quantity which, when integrated, gives a result that is independent of the path between the initial and final states of the system. So the exact differential will be applicable for the state functions, not to the path functions. Now we will see the inexact differential. So inexact differential is a infinitesimal quantity that, when integrated, gives a result that depends only on the path between the initial and final states. So simply we can say that the inexact differential is applicable for the path functions. When a system is heated, consider you are going to heat a system. The total energy is transferred as heat is the sum of all individual contributions at each point of the path. So sum can be denoted by integration term, and here Q is equal to integration of I to F dQ. So this is a path function, so we cannot write it as a delta Q, because heat is not a state function. It does not depend upon initial and final states, but it depends upon the path. And inexact differential is an infinitesimal quantity that, when integrated, it gives a result which depends upon the path between the initial and final states. So the change in internal energy is exact differential, and change in heat is an inexact differential.